Let's talk about two dogs. In fact, two dogs dominate Italian politics in the last few days, actually a few weeks. One dog is called MP, and it's a dog that my good old friend Dario Vignardi, who's the host of the TV show called Invasioni Barbariche, is a little white puppy, and she decided to, you know, out of the blue, Mario Monti was there before the election, giving this sort of large interview, and this little puppet, and Dario wanted Mario Monti to show that he's a human being with passion and he loves a puppy and everything. And Mario Monti was actually did well, I think, but apparently he hated the whole thing, and yesterday he hinted that maybe his performance not exactly fantastic as a politician's, and definitely at the polls, was because of the little white dogs. And my friend Dario Vignardi should not have done that. The other, so we'll go into Monti in a minute. The idea, Mario Monti was the hope of Italian politics in many ways, but the hope of Italian politics in places like Oxford, Harvard, Washington, London, and Berlin. In fact, I know, not I heard, but I know for sure that one of the reasons why he decided to run, there are people who really insisted. One is Angela Merkel, another is Barack Obama. They met him and said, this is a resource, this is a man that could do well, we can trust, we can talk to. Of course, his English is good. And Mario Monti had, Mario Monti was important in Italy, was an important man, and a great role. But Mario Monti forgot that he was, basically, Italy went to Mario Monti in late 2011, as you go into an emergency room after a car accident. You go and you're grateful, but you don't want to see that particular doctor every day having dinner at your place. You don't want him as Father Christmas. You know, being an emergency doctor is a very difficult position to be. And he forgot that. He thought he was very... what Angela Merkel and Barack Obama and many others forgot to tell Mario Monti is that he would be a very popular politician, maybe in Baden-Württemberg, but not. The point is, in Italy, Italians vote. And Mario Monti lacks the sort of empathy that you need in most countries, not only in Italy, I think David Cameron has got a common touch that Mario Monti is an academic, very rarely an academic, and I know where I'm saying this, an academic can be a good politician. There are two different jobs. Journalists, unfortunately, can be good politicians, but I am not one of them. The second dog is Dudu. Dudu is the dog that is sort of represents the possible retirement of Silvio Berlusconi. After all that happened, and I'm not going to go into too many details, I wrote this book, came out in the United States in 2011, and because of this cover, I was sent to secondary inspection at Logan Airport in Boston. I'm not making this up, because they say, what are you doing here? I'm on a book tour. What did you write? A book, my prime minister. Can I see the book? I show the book, it cannot be your prime minister. Secondary inspection. 3 hours with sort of strange people from all over the world. Then they look me up and they say, and it's also interesting how I think my American publisher was like 2 hours debating where they had the right Berlusconi, the right hand should go. Up, down, or where? Anyway, Berlusconi, after, you know, I'm not, sort of, you don't need a summary of Italian history, but we all thought somehow that he would retire. And Dudu, the wild little dog, represented the retirement. He got together, got engaged to this extremely young woman, age 27 or 28, Francesca Pascale from Naples, who said, a determined young woman who said, I'm going to marry this man, and she's trying hard. And she brought a little white, again, another white puppy with her, and Dudu. And I have to say that Dudu has all my respect. I think Dudu I know who I'm talking to. Dudu is a great a political figure, because he's the only one in the Italian highest echelons of powers who didn't have a silly comments in the last few weeks. So all my respect for Dudu. Everybody else is. As you said, the situation is Scelta Civica, a smaller party, Mario Monti resigned while his successor Enrico Letta was sitting in front of Barack Obama in the Oval Office. If he had thought about that, that's bad. If he had not thought about that, that's bad. I mean, you are a professional politician who's been a prime minister, and his party split between a sort of Christian democratic wing, and in fact the title tonight could be actually someone tweeted that, and maybe the person who tweeted that is this woman. I congratulate her because it's a her, it's a she, and it's a Italy between a shameless right and a hopeless left and a never-ending center, which is interesting. So there is people who are thinking of reforming a kind of Christian democracy. So they're split. The Berlusconi party is also split. People that want to be in government, and of course if you look at Alfano, the deputy prime minister, is his time, the time of his life, is his big chance to become his own man. And he's obvious, and I know what I'm saying. In public, you can say whatever he wants, but my sources are not good, are excellent. And I tell you that the man is just praying for Berlusconi just to go into retirement and spend more time with Dudu and Francesca, let him have his chance. So they are split, and there are other people who depend on Berlusconi for the future, and they are the so-called hoax that they want the government to collapse. The two parties and the Democratic Party, what do? They are split. They are split now, not only because they have the election of the new secretary, but because there are people that think Matteo Renzi is going to be the only chance of the Democratic Party, and people think Matteo Renzi is too modern, too sort of easygoing, too simpatico, and it's not good. And the left, it doesn't represent the left. So you have three parties joined in the same government, split, each one split in two big parties, in two parts, and arguing among themselves. So after they finish arguing, within the party, they start arguing with each other. I was at Ballarò, which is a well-known Italian political sort of talk show, I think it's best, on Tuesday night, and I had this former minister from PDL, Bernini, and Fassina, the deputy minister of the PD, and they were arguing like people, like enemies, political enemies during a campaign before the election. And I just snapped and I said, I understand you, you happen to be in the same government. And so what is going to happen? Is Berlusconi coming back? My time is up, so no. No, Berlusconi, this is important for you to know, our British friends, Italians, Berlusconi is not coming back. Italian has moved over. I have time later to explain why I'm so sure, but that's not enough. That's not enough. You know, Berlusconi has already used this sort of, it's like a dance. He steps back when he's in trouble and lets other people to take the blame for whatever, then he gets back in. He used to do that. But I don't think this is what is going to happen this time. But Italy has got so many problems in economic problem, the South. I was talking to a young woman from Puglia, and I know she's here tonight, and I have a good friend from Sicily also in the room tonight, and we were talking today what's happened to the Italian South, and it's something that in Europe we don't talk about anymore. Britain managed to rescue the North. Germany managed to rescue the East. In Italy we failed, and it's not a failure of the South, it's a national failure. And that's the sort of thing we should tackle immediately about youth unemployment. And what do we do? We have these people arguing and arguing and arguing. That's why I'm so pleased to be in Oxford, to speak for 10 minutes about politics, and then for the next fortnight to think about something else. You have plenty of questions you can ask, and I'll try to answer, but I'm sure now you'll have the political juice from Ferdinando. Thank you.
Thanks, Beppe. I'll try to be short myself, because I'm sure you have plenty of questions for him. When I was coming in, I just thought another way to look at your title and your talks has given me the same impression, is that probably there is a hopeless country and a shameless political class. I think that's an equally valid summary. And I'm saying it because I've, over the last few months, I've become increasingly more pessimistic about what's going to happen to Italy, both in the short run and in the medium run. And I'll explain to you why, and maybe I hope Beppe will cheer me up afterwards. In the short run, I think it's just because the more I look at this government, the more I think it's achieving very little. And it reminds me of an obituary which we run of Andreotti, the great, one of the most powerful political characters in post-war history, and my colleague who wrote the obituary said he will be remembered more for the way he kept power than for anything which he achieved with it. And I have a feeling that this government is kind of doing the same thing, will be remembered for how it managed to stay alive by surviving the latest the latest moves by Berlusconi, for example, a couple of weeks ago, a comprehensive and very impressive defeat by Enrico, which Enrico Letta imposed on Berlusconi, but it's actually achieving very, very little. And if we look, for example, at the latest budget, which Italy's passed, I don't know if any of you have seen it. My colleague Wolfgang Munkau on the FT today defined it awful. Which is English, it's kind of not really English understatement, I would say. But even if we want to be kinder to Mr. Letta's budget, I would use another definition, which is basically this was ordinary maintenance work for a house which is falling apart. The Italian economy is certainly falling apart, and there we are tweaking, you know, that window, whether or not, you know, it's fixed properly or not. So my first question to Beppe, in a sense, is we have this government which was supposed to, you know, bring everyone together and try to do something important for the economy. It's not doing very much at all, and at times what it does doesn't do it very well, I think. So is this a good thing? Should we should this government survive, or if it does survive, should we be worried? Wouldn't it be better to have an election? My pessimism is due to the fact that this government will survive, but will not achieve very much. So we'll be stuck with just a continuation of more of the same, of the economic policies, for example, which have brought Italy to the brink of collapse, because that's where we were 2 years ago when Italy went to meet Professor Monti in the emergency room. You know, the same recipes will be used over and over again with more failures. So that's in the short run. But I'm also pessimistic in the long run, just to cheer you all up. And that's because people say, you know, some say, oh, we are in a moment of transition in Italian history. Look, as Beppe said, on the left, we've got Alfano and some new guys who are just desperate. They want, you know, Berlusconi is not going to come back. There are these people who will, you know, finally will be their moment. And Alfano is less than 40, he's around 40 years old, so very young. Maybe, you know, maybe he's got some new ideas, which we haven't seen yet, but maybe they're there. And, you know, there will be change in the center-right. Center-left, same thing, you know. The old dinosaurs, they're over. If you look at the primaries, which the Democratic Party is just about to have, the three people who are running in it, they're all young. One of them, Matteo Renzi, is this wonderful, very, you know, simpatico guy who not only can win elections, but he also has a wonderful economic program which he will implement. He was on the front page of Time magazine, so even in Washington they love him. And, you know, he speaks English, so it's great. And at the same time, you've also got some sort of demand for change. Forget about Beppe Grillo. What matters is that Italians really want to get rid of this political class. And it doesn't matter that they got it wrong the first time by voting for someone, Beppe Grillo, who's not doing a particularly impressive job, I think. But that means that there is, you know, he's shaking up, the Italians are shaking up the political system. And that means that between this combination of demand from change from the Italian people and a supply of new, you can see I'm an economist, sorry, of new talent, Renzi and others, Italy will finally emerge from this terrible situation it's in. And I just can't see that happening, to be honest. And that's because when you start thinking about what, you know, the political class in 10 years, I can see the same biases, the same problems which have characterized political, for example, political selection in Italy, like nepotism you know, the choice of people based more on connections than on actual talent. So I see the old biases still there. Two, I see the effects of emigration having a big effect. You just need to walk around Oxford or London to understand. This is a historical change. What's happening at the moment? There is an entire class of people of my age, your age, who just left the country. And frankly, the longer goes on, the less intention they have of going back. And this has an effect. Many of these people are the people who you would hope were in parliament, you know, will be in parliament in 5-10 years' time. Some of them now work for the Bank of England. Some of them now work for the Westminster. Some of them now work for the English government, the British government. And this is the ruling class, which is just gone. And you know, you're not going to replace that very easily. And my third point is just that there hasn't been any effort in Italy over the past 20, 25 years of forming a ruling class. This is the biggest, I think, single biggest defeat, the problem which Italy faces at the moment. I mean, political class, but also outside. I mean, we've just seen what disasters the entrepreneurs can do in Italy. I don't know if you follow what's happened to Alitalia, the Italian airline company, where the old principle of privatizing profits and socializing losses was applied very well. There was certainly a certain amount of political skills involved, especially by Mr. Berlusconi 5 years ago, but let's say entrepreneurs also added their own talent, and that meant that we have an airline which is in disastrous condition, just as a few years ago, with the difference that now Italians have paid 3 billion to rescue it. So all I'm saying is there hasn't been any attempt to form, nurture talent, and that will show off, because you don't improvise a political class, you do not improvise a ruling class or an elite, which I know is a very out of fashion and ugly word, but I believe it's something which matters. Hence, my case for pessimism. Now, I know Beppe is very good at cheering us all up, so I very much hope that he will cheer me up as much as he will cheer you up. Okay, thank you.
Okay, well, pessimistic scenarios on the whole. Now, while the audience is gathering its thoughts and trying to find a counter-argument to what Ferdinando has just said, let me ask Beppe a question about, which is essentially one of political pettegolezzo. Supposing we agreed that the person in the Italian Parliament, well, not the person in the Italian Parliament, the group in the Italian Parliament, with a very strong reason for keeping Berlusconi in the Senate, is Cinque Stelle. And supposing their efforts are not entirely sincere, and the vote, which is held in a couple of weeks' time, on the expulsion of Mr. Berlusconi from the Senate, which apparently is the tombstone on his political career, as you have argued, and supposing that vote is indeed held in secret rather than openly, who has the strongest interest in voting to keep him in the Senate? Berlusconi's own supporters, and after that, Cinque Stelle, I guess. Is that a possible way out for him? Can he pull something out of the fire which would mean that he won't disappear from Italian politics quite as quickly as you say? Is that a possibility?
Of course it's a possibility, but some of my countrymen and country women, they are too young to remember it, but in the early 90s what happened with Bettino Craxi is that there was a vote in parliament, and then surprisingly the vote in parliament prevented Craxi to be dismissed, and in fact it was the end of an era nonetheless. So I don't think that this vote will be that important. I don't think Berlusconi in a few months will be able to lead his own people. Also, I do believe some of his own people in a secret ballot have plenty of reason to decide. Yeah. So some Cinque Stelle may want to have Berlusconi in, but some of his own people, believe me, have plenty of reason to decide that it's time, you know, otherwise they'll never have a chance to. Right. To. That's one thing. But Berlusconi, it's over, because Berlusconi is it's a bit of an addiction we are getting over. I mean, the people that anybody who's got an internet connection probably won't vote for Berlusconi, apart from very few. I mean, a few. In fact, only two Italian out of three have a fast internet connection. And Berlusconi knows very well. And the third of Italia means you can reach through television. That's why he's so smart. And that's why me, like Catone, would say, Delenda Cartago, and I had a piece in Corriere every 3 weeks. Look, conflict of interest, the idea that one of the main political actors still have three televisions and can... if you look at the palinsesti, how is they are organized now, you can see they are moving fast to for the next campaign. It won't work. I think it's Berlusconi is it won't work. I mean, it's Berlusconi is at the same, that's basically why I wrote a book about him, is that he represents some of the best and much of the worst in the country. I'm not, in Italian I say, non ho paura di Berlusconi in sé, ho paura di Berlusconi in me. In English it's not as nice. I'm not afraid of Berlusconi as such. I'm worried about Berlusconi in myself. I know of no single Italian who's got 0% of Berlusconi in here. If you try... Okay, can I ask you a few questions? Can I talk to your lawyer, to your accountant, and to your confessor, to your wife? Privately? Probably he's got, if he raises and he's got like 5%. Below 50%.
What's your percentage rate?
Oh, definitely below 50%. I don't know, but I remember that I had the same line. The Brown University, a young student, like she was a student, like a master's student. She was writing the story about Berlusconi in my book after my talk at Brown University, and I explained this thing about percentage of the Berluscometro, to measure the percentage of. I have this Berluscometro. In fact, I got it here. If you want to try it later, I'll try the Berluscometro. And she she wrote it all down, and then he said, yes, in fact, I can see the point. Definitely Mr. Severnini is not a Berlusconi fan, and he's never voted for Mr. Berlusconi, but I can see that he's got at least 15-20% of Berlusconi in him, because he asked me for coffee after the interview. That was it. She was an extremely good-looking young woman, and she decided that... in fact, I wanted to be polite, but it struck me how, you know, the way you refer to you look at things, and so Berlusconi is a way of looking at the world. That's why it will always be there, and someone will get that kind of buzz. But I think his time is up. His time is up because in his own party people are restless, and I know lots of them. And privately they tell you, we hope. So why don't you speak up? If we speak up, we're dead, politically dead. But now they realize maybe they're not dead. That's one thing. Let me answer you briefly. I'm pessimistic in the short run, but a little bit more optimistic in the long run. And I tell you why. First of all, we desperately need to change the electoral law now. This is the recipe for disaster. I'm speaking to the British part of the audience, because the Italians know this extremely well. This electoral law is a disaster on two accounts. Number one, it's a disaster because it will never give you a clear winner. It is true that in Britain you managed to not to produce a winner even with your electoral law, but in Italy this is very simple, because in the Senate, the majority, there is a special, we call it premio di maggioranza, an extra seats for people who come first. It's not as in the lower chamber, given on a national basis, but on a regional basis. It means that you are first in the Senate in Emilia-Romagna, as the PD, Democratic Party, always, you get special extra seats. But the Northern League is going to be first or maybe second in Veneto, and definitely the Berlusconi Party is going to lead in at least 4 or 5, the centre-right. It means that no one with this electoral law will have a majority in the Senate. It happens already, and it's going to happen again. It's a certainty.
Well, they got a majority in 2008.
Yeah, but that was a very unusual, because Berlusconi was strong and the
left. It can happen.
Yeah, it can happen. It is true, but it was a kind of suicide by the left, as you know. It doesn't happen every day. And second, because this parliament is much better in terms of people than the parliament that just was the left. The new parliament is actually better. You have good, some of the people there are good. You can talk to them, they're good, they're there for a reason. In fact, within Certacifica there are good people that are within PD, and even, I knew that Enrico Letta will pick those ministers, because I know Beatrice Lorenzin personally, and I know others, and they are the sort of people that could be part of a centre-right government in other parts of Europe. I mean, there is nothing. Actually, they are kind of smart and articulate. I mean, they had to keep their heads low very often with Berlusconi. But there are people. You know about Senatore Razzi? You know who he is?
Yes.
Senatore Razzi was elected in the foreign. There was a special worldwide electoral college, and he was elected there. I think in 2006, and then because he is one of the. Of those who left the centre-left to support Berlusconi, the so-called responsible with Schipa, basically he got a safe seat from Berlusconi. Safe seat, they're all safe seats, because that's my point. The second reason why this electoral law is a disaster is that the leader of the parties, Berlusconi, Beppe Grillo, whoever will be in charge of the Democratic Party, Mario Monti, can write down the list. And if you're top of the list, you are going to be in parliament no matter what. And they have the power of, I like you, I don't like you. You to speak too much, I don't want you in, you're very pretty, you're going to be in, and so on and so on. That's the way Italian politics has been working. It's a shame. It's a real shame. And in fact, I was almost the beneficiary of this, because I know there is a camera, but I think one should declare that his or her interest. I have two friends in Italian politics, one is Enrico Letta, one is Matteo Renzi, and together they asked me to say, come and be the top of the list in Lombardy. That means you are senator for sure. And I decided that I didn't want to be a senator, I didn't want to be in politics, and I like what I'm doing. But I mean, the way they picked me, they could pick anyone. And this Senatore Razzi was Berlusconi insider. After all, he wanted to have him in. And this is, we're talking about a man who's the Segretario of the Foreign Committee in the Italian Italian Senate. And you know what he did? He went to North Korea and he came back and he said, and people asked me, I mean, why did you go there in a way to give credibility to the worst dictatorship on the planet? And he said, dictatorship, authoritarian, it reminds me of Switzerland. That's a quote. I mean, this thing is, you laugh, but you're talking about someone sitting in the Italian Senate. Everyone else will be dismissed in any democracy. If you go to North Korea, you come back and say, everything is fine, looks like Switzerland. So that's number one, change electoral law. That's the first thing. In order for these people to be out, and you know, for anyone, Beppe Severgnini or Senatore Razzi, to go in front of the people and say, you want me, and you have to, and people have to decide if they want you. If you are terrible, there is no way you can make it. Now, as long as the boss wants, you are in. That's the one. The second thing is actually the third, and I'll stop here, is that Beppe Grillo was an attempt, a shout, an attempt of the Italian nation want to say enough. And the Italian nations and Italian voters have tried, we all of us, to shout in many different ways. Voting for the Northern League in 92-93 was a shout. Enough of the traditional parties. These barbarians, okay, the most ugly they look, the better it is. The Berlusconi in his own way in 94 was a shout. Enough. We'll have this businessman going into politics. Okay, he's got his own television, but who cares? Let the British worry about these details of democracy that if you are a politician, you shouldn't own the BBC and Channel 4. Let's try with him, and then we know what happened. And so on and so forth. Even the referendum with Mario Seni in 93, it was a shout. Italians couldn't care less about the single preference in the electoral ballot. It was just a way. The more the politicians said we don't like him, the more. So Italy has been trying. And the last of these shout enough was Beppe Grillo. Beppe Grillo tried to convince us that people voted for his program. Absurd. People voted simply because he was so... the traditional politician despised him and disliked him so much that was what really made him interesting for the rest of. And that's why the foreign press, including the British press, fell for this. I have been talking to excellent political commentator in Britain who generally thought the Beppe Grillo could be some kind of solution. Because they dislike traditional Italian politics so much that after all Beppe Grillo is, and they say no, it's going to be yet another disappointment. And obviously, Matteo Renzi used this expression saying Beppe Grillo won the lottery and threw away the winning tickets is a way of putting. I use another metaphor and I said that Beppe Grillo went fishing and instead of a carp he picked up a whale. 9 million votes and he doesn't know what to do. He's there with this little boat and a whale and the whale has woken up. And the whale has woken up and dragged Beppe Grillo here and there, and we know what is going to happen. Why I'm optimistic, but I don't think Beppe Grillo has a chance to do it again. So there is an error there. Matteo Renzi on the center left, someone on the center right, even someone in the center. There is a huge political space to be occupied soon. Why do we don't want an election and people like me are worried? Because an election in March, that the sooner, will be yet another referendum of Berlusconi. And we cannot afford that. Economically, financially, psychologically. I mean, enough. So I think, but it is true that I said, Ricoletta, I've known him for many years, and we've seen each other when he was not prime minister, of course, and he's a good person. He's trying hard, but you're right. I agree with you that it's sad to see that because they quarrel and they discuss, they are down to the sort of the lowest common denominator. They only go for the thing that don't bother anyone. And if you want to do something in Italy, if you want to go forward, you have to bother a lot of people. If you don't do that, Italy will never change. Because it's a column I wrote in Corriere della Sera this morning about the complication is an industry in Italy. And so there are people who live off complicating your life in state, in the civil service, in professions, here and there. And you have to bother all these people in order to introduce the right legislation. You have to bother a lot of people. Only someone who has the will and the strength to fight that battle could bring Italy out of the quagmire, I think.
Okay, audience time. What have we concluded so far? Things are bad. Berlusconi's not coming back. Not time for an election, but Ferdinando may have different views. Electoral reform needed before we do that. Glimmers of hope on the horizon from new generations of politicians. I think we've heard that one before, but we'll talk about it. Questions, comments? Ivan.
Well, I can think of one other democracy where coming back from North Korea and making absurd comments about Switzerland would not get you removed from the parliament, and it's a democracy whose centre is only about 60 miles away from here. As you know, the House of Lords is pretty hard to get removed from. But to look again at Italian politics, what you the divisions within the key parties within the governing coalition that you've described make the divisions within British politics seem very minor within the coalition partners in our government. And I find it hard to square those divisions with what you say about, you know, we can't have early elections. We know that the president doesn't want early elections and can see all the downside to it. But can you really see this government carrying on for another, say, 2 years, achieving, as Ferdinando says, extremely little or almost nothing? Is that realistic? And are we not really trying to see a chase between early elections and getting the electoral law through first? There's an awful lot of vested interests against having the electoral law reformed. Why would Turkey's vote for an early Christmas, for instance? And perhaps you could also say a word about the constitutional proposals from the wise group of 30-plus members.
No.
I agree with
the constitutional wise men. You know, some of them, you probably don't know this, got into trouble because there were some university arrangement not quite right, and they have been investigated. You know, I'm talking about the wise men. Think of the others. I think the President Napolitano is right to go. Of course, he cannot say, I don't want an election because there's going to be yet another referendum on Berlusconi. You really don't need that, of course. But the electoral law is alone. The fact that with this electoral law is almost certain, given the opinion polls, unless they are completely wrong, that we're going to reproduce a situation like this, where the only way to form a government is to bring together people who despise each other. Not only dislike, but despise and they hate each other, which you have a coalition in this country, and I know the problem you're going through, and I think you are, I think in the American had their problem with the Tea Party, but don't forget you are better with tea than they are, so watch out, because what is happening in the Conservative Party, I think, is going to be very interesting in the next couple of years. So you about split and distinction, and you're talking about a huge issue, which is Europe, of course, coming up for you. So is this thing happening everywhere? The problem is that in Italy, with this electoral law, we're going to have a coalition of people who don't want. I mean, the Liberal Party and the Conservative Party obviously do not love each other, but they know they have to be together. In Germany, it's not when the Große Coalition was formed that all of a sudden they decided they shared it, but they decided that actually having a huge majority in parliament was the right time to pass that what we all hoped. I mean, you're all together now, but what they do is what every day they're trying to blame the other. So they are doing two things at the same time. Running the country, being governed, and campaigning, which is against each other, which is nuts. And that's why it's so schizophrenic and going on television and seeing these people shouting at each other and then they say, hey, you're in the same government. Have you forgotten that? But with this electoral law, I think it's dangerous. I rarely use this word, but it's dangerous to go back, because this time, re-electing Napolitano, having a Ricoletta, who's after all is not a responsible person at all, and they out of a terrible situation, they managed to come up with this solution. It's not a fudge. Often in politics we have fudges with other names, but next time it's going to be different, because the economic situation is improved in terms of public expenditure. We know that. I mean, but he's better. He's more has more titles to talk about this than I am. But it is true that we have problems going from youth unemployment, which is extraordinary and offensive, and what is happening in the South. The Italian South is something that it doesn't make headlines anymore, but is a real tragedy. I mentioned that before. And I know that in this room there are a lot of people that are not in the statistics, and the statistics say that 150,000 people leave Southern Italy every year. 70% of them are young. But then, all of you that come from Southern Italy, probably you're not in those 150,000 simply because you didn't, non avete cambiato la residenza, you're still resident where you are. So you're talking about 150,000 plus you and all the others. And this is a real problem because it's a time bomb, the Italian South. And I've been there so often because of my latest book about young people going to Puglia and Calabria and Sicily and Sardinia many times. And it's a real time bomb. And something is going to happen. In this condition, you're going to have an election with this electoral law and you don't know what's going to happen. Wow. I employ, apart from what I get from the papers, I have two people on my own. Tempo indeterminato, sort of full-time paid people, but I needed for project someone else, and I wanted to take someone who could learn and grow and whatever, and I hired a girl, an internship. I found out, and I'm paying her well, by the way, it's important. Young people should be paid. I was at Confindustria Naples the other day, and I was so proud to say in front of 500 young, say, I ragazzi vanno pagati. Let's say something, it's not possible that we have a system called stage. We use the French or stage, you know, stage. The internship, which originally was a way whereby the companies could help young people, it turned out to be a system whereby young people help companies working for free. It's crazy. And you know what I found out? I found out that in order to have an intern, she or he needs to be physically sitting in the same office. The Italian law does not provide for anybody working away from you, which all of us work with people that we don't see every day, and we work with plenty of ways to do it nowadays. Yeah, you hiring young people, it takes one afternoon. You say, all of this, go. There are plenty of commission who came up with good recipes to clear the air, change things. They came up with something called Sportello Unico per le Imprese. It means you want a new company, there is one place where you have to go and everything will be sorted out for you. You can start your company with no red tape. The problem is we produce red tape. Like, red tape is still Italy's biggest industry. And what people have forgotten, the reason is, behind every crazy regulation, every useless piece of legislation, every crazy codicillo, there is people whose business is to keep those going. Private professions, civil service. I know I said this before, but this is important. And all you need to do as a prime minister is to be absolutely bold, barricade yourself inside Palazzo Chigi and just go. You don't need to introduce the legislation. There are so many areas of Italy where you can really, but of course, a lot of people are going to hate you. And you know you have to be unpopular. And if that's the point, you need to be a little populist. There is an element of populism which is crucial. Boris Johnson uses a lot to run London. Even Cameron, in his own way, is. Otherwise, you're not a politician. You have to become do it in a nice way and explain. Stop quarreling. Even television, because you cannot quarrel at night on television and the next morning come up and with a sort of serious face and propose something serious after you sort of gave a horrible show or spectacle of yourself on television. There are many things, but I think a new prime minister, I hope Matteo Renzi can be the man. I know him well. I've known him for 8 years. We discussed this a lot. He has to remember Yes, one thing worries me about Matteo Renzi is that sometimes he's so enthusiastic about things that he launches new announcement, and I told him, Matteo, this country is sinking. Stiamo affogando fra gli annunci. And it is a real problem. But he could be the one. I'm sure as soon as Berlusconi goes, someone on the center-right is ready to do the same if they win an election. And even the center and Scelta Civica can come up with a few names that actually could help. They're not worse than British or French or German politicians. Trust me, I can come up with many names. Irene Tinagli, Ilaria Capua, Scelta Civica, Alessia Mosca, Partito Democratico, Lorenzino, or many others. I can give you many names. They're not hopeless. Not at all. They have a good background. They really mean it. They went into politics. They want to change things and not to make money or feel important. But you have to give them a chance. And someone has to go and do it. And in order to do that, you need to have 5 years and to accept to be unpopular. There is an army of angry young people in Italy. An army of angry young people that Beppe Grillo managed to recruit and then wasted, and I know the word I'm using, wasted that power and that anger, and that is a real shame. But if that anger can be put to the right use with a real leader, I think that a lot of young people, some of them are in this room, they may even come back one day, but you have to see someone who's ready to go for it. Otherwise, people will vote with their feet, as we say, and come to England, go to Britain, go everywhere. I travel a lot, and I tell you, not in Oxford, everywhere. In England, in Germany, in Scandinavia, in America, in Australia now, a lot. You walk into every lab, every office in the world, every every university, every bank, every office has got a computer, a pot plant, and an Italian.
And quite a few of them are here. So before we finish, does anybody want to talk about this great white hope of Matteo Renzi? Yes.
I do, sir. One thing that worries me about Matteo Renzi is the fact that this person was hired to do a very specific job. He's been paid to run a large city, and he seems to be doing very much that is not run this large and important city. So as an Italian living abroad, I don't feel I can trust this person to do a job, because he's not doing a very good job at the job that he's actually hired to do and paid to do. So could you comment on that, since you seem to have brought yourself from America?
Do you want to start, Philip?
Just a couple of questions, a couple of quick answers. First one, I don't think he's alone in being a person with an important administrative job and having political ambition. There is another example 60 kilometers away from here, Boris Johnson, is exactly the same. And you know, people seem to, they've re-elected him as mayor. You know, I'm not expressing my personal preference, but you know, Londoners seem to want him as mayor. And at the same time, he's clearly desperate to seize his chance to become the next prime minister of this country. I don't think the two things are incompatible. Second point is actually, I disagree with your statement that people in Florence don't think he's doing a good job. If you look at it at the primaries of the Democratic Party, Matteo Renzi lost everywhere in Italy. There was one region and one city where one region and one big city where he won. They were Tuscany and Florence. Had they really hated him, the people from the Democratic Party during those primaries would have gone there and voted Bersani en masse. That didn't happen, which suggests to me that they don't think he's doing such a terrible job.
Yeah, that makes me a little uncomfortable as well, I have to say, to be honest. And I told him. He's right. There is an example in London, and if you take an American senator, you know, if he's running for president, forget about being a senator and being in the Senate and doing what you have been elected for. So there are many examples around the world of people who, when they have higher political ambition, try to combine two things. I don't think that's a the biggest problem. The biggest problem is what I said, is patience, is extremely good in public, is extremely, he's got that politician touch. The Boris Johnson has, Tony Blair had, further Barack Obama in the first, Bill Clinton has. If you see Matteo walking into a room, he can work a room like no one else. Is that's a politician, right or left, they have to do that. I'm sure I've seen the best and the worst, but a politician has to do that. A politician needs to do things and have qualities that a diplomat or a writer does not need. And he's got, but his impatience worries me. And the second thing that I think he has to be very careful, he has to start creating a group of people around him that, like almost a cabinet in waiting, people that could help him out and give him advice. He asks too many people, too many questions, and the danger is there. There are self-appointed advisors that come up out of nowhere. It's very difficult to contact him. I had a very important ambassador of an important European country who came to me and he said, it's really not good that I represent a big country and four times I tried to get to know him and say, can we meet somewhere sometime? It's important for me to tell my government what you want to do. And it's really, and I'm sure Matteo didn't even know about this request. And I think, not because I was here, but I think if you are a prime minister, even if you are a prospective prime minister, and if you have a big country and his ambassador, you should absolutely find the time. I have to find out, but I'm pretty sure that he never got the news, which is even worse. It means that it's a system whereby it's surrounded by, we communicate by SMS. And so he takes too many commitments. Sometimes he stands people up. Can I say that? Yes. Like he doesn't show up, and these are the problem. But and then finally, and most important, since we're talking about him, I just said that I turned him down, and I didn't want to be a senator. So I'm not after anything. I'm just doing my job. And judging someone and declaring my interest, the fact that I consider him a friend. But I think he has to come up soon and tell you, me, him and the FT, what he wants to do with Italy, and going into details. Some of the Crozza, Crozza is a comedian, very funny on television. He's very subtle. I consider him one of the best Italian political commentators, me. And Crozza, when he decided to pick on Renzi, and he has this Renzi using the most amazing words, but saying nothing. And that's he has to be very careful with that, because if you are a politician, it's bad for journalists to do this, it's bad for academics, but if you are a politician and you are running to lead a country with the problems of Italy, you have to explain exactly what you're going to do about labor market, exactly what you're going to do about taxes, exactly what you're going to do about pension reform. Even if you want to do something bold, do it. Try. Because that's the other thing. Italy is getting old. So the problem, many of the things that Italy need, the voters don't want them. Because the voters are old and they are voting for pensions. We are spending so much more for pension than Germany is.
But Beppe, can I ask you, supposing he gets to be leader, and actually he wins what counts as winning an election, can he then control his own party? Will they fall in behind him?
No.
That seems to me the critical question, the relationship with the Democrats. What are the Democrats now? Are they leadable?
Can I add my word of skepticism? Is just going back to my gloominess. I think there is something worrying about a country which turns to the mayor of its, what is it, seventh largest city, with no other significant political experience. I mean, yes, he was president of the province, to go and rescue it. We have seen what happens to the shooting stars of politics, Barack Obama, David Cameron. I consider both of them not a huge success. We're talking here about a person with far less experience than any of the two, because at least Obama was a senator and I think Cameron was an MP. Here we're talking about the mayor of the sixth or seventh largest city in Italy.
Well, but at least he runs something, Florence. And it's a complicated city in its own. The Florentines have a very lively character and they tell you things. My books in Florence, he always was your job. He did it once. It was very funny because he interviewed me on the Berlusconi book. And he read all the questions, written questions coming from the audience in the Salone di Cinquecento a Palazzo Vecchio. And some were really nasty questions about him. And he said, can you ask Beppe Severgnini why the mayor of Florence has such a silly idea as to go to Arcole to see Berlusconi? And he will read them with a straight face. And he was, so, and when we go out in Florence, people tell you things that you cannot imagine. I mean, and he has a word for everyone. It's like he loves doing that. I couldn't do that job. And then Italy is in a position that we have to take a chance. You're right about Democratic Party, but first of all, some of the people are out and some of the people will be out. If he's got a huge success at the primaries, and if you go around, the people have the feeling that the only chance of winning are there, enough of losing the Democratic Party. It is not my, you know, I come from a different sort of political school and ideas than they are. But it is a fact that they lost this time. They were absolutely certain to win, they lost. So they want to win.
They're like Inter 20 years ago.
Forget about Inter Milan. We'll talk about that.
Or the Labour Party in 1997.
Inter was more desperate.
It is a fact. It is a fact that you need to take a chance, Ferdinand. You need to take a chance. And I realized that ideally you need someone a little older, with a good background, internationally experienced, who was already, you know, a mayor and twice a minister, and we don't have that person. And maybe a woman, I think that would be a good idea. We don't have that person. There is a chance, taking a chance, but what is the alternative? The alternative is going back, and what is Casini the alternative?
Okay.
Casino è un sostantivo, non un nome.
I'll take a question from the man who says he has 0% of Berlusconi in him.
I would like to go back to the title, really, because my question would essentially be what right and what left, or even what centre. The problem is, you know, here we go again. Why? Because, yes, here we go again. I'm very pessimistic, like Ferdinando, because at the end of the day, if we want change, you either have two options: cultural change, which will take generations, and maybe 9 million vote for Beppe Grillo was, you know, a good indication that maybe that something happened. But the only change is legislation. And how are you going to achieve that? How can you hope to do that when this parliament could not even elect a new president? They re-elected an 88-year-old man to ensure that, you know, their seat is safe. At the end of the day, what we have in Italy is a gang, is a clique. The crime rate in the parliament is 1 out of 10 should be in prison, or they are investigated for fraud, tax evasion, you name it. If you go in the street, you find less crime rate. And, you know, they are there to save their ass. That's all they're doing. How can you hope that they're going to change? They're not even going to change the electoral turnover, because it's in their interest to keep it. And they showed it over the last 20 years, 40 years, 60 years, they are there for that reason. No other reason. They're not there because they have a right politics or a left politics. They're just there to save their ass. And Berlusconi is just the best example. But he's just 1 out of 900.
Okay, well, both of you use that. Use that populist response as a peg to wrap it up, and then we'll conclude. Ferdinando first.
Well, I think, I mean, many of the things you've said are absolutely right. And I think there is, I mean, what I find quite shocking, to be honest, is the fact that there was such a big wave of discontent. And my interpretation of Beppe Grillo, you can interpret it in many ways, but my interpretation, for example, here in this country, they love to interpret it as an anti-Euro vote. Rubbish. I think it was an anti-political caste vote, and also generally angerness of the system. But let's. And the fact that after this huge wake-up call, like massive, 9 million strong wake-up call, there hasn't been a single attempt at cutting the wage, or a very tiny attempt at cutting the wage of parliamentarians. There hasn't been a real attempt at cutting down the number of parliamentarians. There hasn't been a real attempt at simplifying the way to get rid of someone who has committed significant crime. Although, to be fair, maybe we're seeing that the Monti government had done something, because ultimately the law passed under the previous government is helping Berlusconi on his way out, it would seem. So the fact that after this massive wake-up call, forget about, I mean, what I wrote, I remember I was quite involved in writing the editorials just after the election in February. For the Financial Times, and I can't say more. But one of the things we wrote was, guys, Democrats and PDL, you're too different from each other. Forget about economic reform. You're not going to do any, because one of you wants to cut taxes, and the other one doesn't want to cut public spending, and you both want to keep the deficit at the level it is now. So that's an impossible trilogy. It's just not going to happen. What you can do, however, and what you should do, is just reform the political system. You know, it's something which you've just been told to do by 9 million plus Italians. Do it. And the fact that they haven't managed to do something like that, where there was, shows that yes, the system is very, very, very hard to change. Now, I don't want to, you know, I mean, hope, you know, I'm afraid many of those who will come next will be as bad. There is a bit of me which hope, or maybe worse, there is a bit of me which hopes that maybe Beppe is right after all. I don't know.
So, Beppe, you have 2 minutes.
Well, parliaments do strange things. Don't forget what happened in America with the shutdown. I mean, Italy's not alone. And trust me, this parliament, I'm talking about people, is better than the one, the outgoing one. You probably say, it was not difficult, you're right. But it's true that it's the figure that you quoted, and I've quoted often, they refer to the last parliament. This one is a little better. Then with this electoral law, you can bring in everyone. But let me, because I have 2 minutes, actually 1.5, I'm not thinking that Matteo Renzi is the savior, and Nicoletta should become Braveheart or anything. What I'm saying is that Italy needs to take some bold decision very soon, very, very soon. If not, do not expect Italy to blow up. Decline is a very subtle thing that could happen, that happens to nations. It happened to Portugal, it happened to countries that are empires. It happened to the Republic of Venice. The Republic of Venice has been for 300 years the most powerful and vital and dynamic forces, one of the most powerful in Europe and definitely Mediterranean. In the end of the 18th century, they all started to being unable to take decision. They had parties all night. Prostitutes everywhere, there it might be something. It didn't go with a bang. It went, with a whimper. Yeah, a whimper or something. So that what worries me, is that next time we won't even have an evening today where you're angry and I am worried, and at least we show some passion. What worries me is that my son, who's going to be 21 in a few days, and all of you will decide that after all, you know, Italy, the Europe's garden has becoming the continent, the boneyard, and we don't care about it anymore. That will be the catastrophe.
Well, thank you to both. Thank you particularly to Beppe for coming all the way over here, for serving as this year's Isaiah Berlin Visiting Scholar. Tonight's discussion was a kind of microcosm of the current state of debate on Italian politics, a bit chaotic at times. Everything seems to be connected with everything else, and everything looks like it's blocking everything else. Glimmers of hope on the horizon, Mr. Matteo De Renzi as our only apparent hope on the horizon, but a lot of pessimism about that. When you go next Tuesday, as I hope you will, to hear Beppe talk about an entirely different subject, you'll be able to put at least some of this behind you and realise that there's a lot more to Italy than just the froth of day-to-day Italian politics. And so we look forward to that. And we thank these two, Ferdinando as well, for giving us a great evening's entertainment.